It's an honor to be here, an honor to be delivering the Sorensen lecture. Thank you for inviting me. And let's do some work. This is going to be a law professor talking as though to a law class, because I want to take you through a series of cases involving the way in which the legal systems here, there, and everywhere in the world have dealt with the topic of human dignity. You will know, especially those of you who are involved in Christian ethics, that there has been a remarkable amount of work done in recent years on the topic of human dignity. It features prominently in modern human rights charters and in constitutional jurisprudence around the world. Human dignity shall be inviolable, says the opening article of the Basic Law of Germany. To respect and protect it shall be the duty of all state authority. And the preamble to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which is the most important of the modern human rights formulations, tells us that recognition of the inherent dignity of all members of the human family, is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world, and that the rights set out in the covenant derive from the inherent dignity of the human person. Article 3 of the Geneva Conventions, Common Article 3, prohibits outrages on the personal dignity of detainees. The South African Constitution lists dignity alongside freedom and equality and democracy as the cardinal values of the new order in that country. And even nations like the United States that don't actually mention dignity explicitly in their constitutional text have given it a prominent place nevertheless in judicial doctrine. So the Supreme Court of the United States has said again and again that the basic concept underlying the Eighth Amendment, that's a cruel and unusual punishment amendment, the basic concept underlying the Eighth Amendment is nothing less than the dignity of man. Now we're going to revisit many of these formulations in what follows, but I just wanted to give you a sense of what's going on in this field. One slightly worrying feature is that all of this dignity jurisprudence is uncontaminated by any official definition of the concept. Its meaning seems to have been left to intuitive understanding, and some critics, as a result, have attacked the squishy subjectivity of its application in the hands of judges and political commentators who are emancipated from the constraints of any official definition and who have no firm grip on what limits or disciplines its use. Steven Pinker published an article in the New Republic some years ago called The Stupidity of Dignity, and he complained, one of the many things he complained about was the absence of any clear definition. Now, the absence of an official canonical definition doesn't mean that we are short of definitions. Every philosopher with ears has come up with a definition of human dignity. There are dozens of them around, and I'm not sure that we should be joining this parade this evening. Often philosophers will say, look, there are too many definitions of dignity. There are 30 definitions, and here's the 31st, which I shall now offer, and then just adds to the list. I'm a professor of law, as Jennifer said in her very generous introduction, and I think sometimes it's best to approach questions through case law. Oliver Wendell Holmes claimed that the life of the law has been experience rather than logic, rather than the abstract definition of concepts. And so it's worth asking, what has our experience been of human dignity in the life of the law, not just in the formulations of legal philosophers, but in the actual cases that have cropped up and involved? So that's really what I'm going to be exploring tonight. Jürgen Habermas, in his writing on dignity, has pointed out that ideas like dignity may seem to be moral in character, and it's natural to think that the realm of moral speculation is where their meaning needs to be figured out. But notwithstanding their exclusively moral content, he says, they are actually designed to be spelled out in concrete terms through legal processes, to be specified case by case in adjudication. If they're going to do their work, that's going to be one of the areas where they, of course, they have to do their work in people's ethical consciousness as well. But in the framing and organization of social norms, we need to look at the processes that enable that to happen. So I'm presenting you with a docket of cases. I made that up, but actually my wife suggested a docket of cases. I said, you know, we have a gaggle of geese and a choir of angels and a college of cardinals. What do we have for cases? She says, well, the court has a docket of the cases that it has to deal with. So these cases are interesting in their own right. I hope you'll find them intriguing. I've given you a list. I said in my subtitle that I was going to do 8. I've given you a list of 9. I think we're probably going to end up with 7 because we don't have unlimited time this evening. But one additional background question, which justifies bringing this to the Sorensen lectureship, is to ask whether in law dignity has or can have or should have a straightforward secular meaning. Is it a religious term? Does it represent an attempt to convey transcendent meaning, to insinuate that transcendence into our law and public morality? Jennifer has already given us a spoiler on that, because the passage that she quoted from the Imago Dei article indicated my belief that it's partly the function of terms like image of God, terms like human dignity, to refer our status to something unimaginably deep and powerful in the roots of our being and our relation to the one who created us, and that dignity is partly picking up a dimension of majesty as well as inviolability that is supposed to follow from that. But it's a further question whether that deep, compelling meaning can be the primary meaning of the term in the law, and that I want to leave as an open question, murmuring through the analysis of the cases we're going to discuss this evening. I suspect that Steven Pinker's hostility to dignity is in large measure associated with its religious overtones. There has been considerable concern among philosophers who are by no means uniformly enthusiastic about the rise of dignity as a moral concept. There has been concern about the infiltration or the return of religiously loaded ideas into moral and political philosophy. Commenting on the use of the term dignity by members of President George W. Bush's panel on bioethics, Pinker exclaimed incredulously, "How did the United States, the world's scientific powerhouse, reach a point at which it grapples with the ethical challenges of 21st century biomedicine, issues about the commodification of embryos, for example, using Bible stories, Catholic doctrine, and woolly rabbinical allegory?" Yeah? All of it sort of keyed in by this concept of dignity. Certainly, dignity occupies an important role in recent religious thought, both in Reformed moral theology, I'm thinking of Jürgen Moltmann's writing, and in Catholic moral theology. At the beginning of the 1995 encyclical Evangelium Vitae, we are told that the gospel of God's love for man, the gospel of the dignity of the person, and the gospel of life are a single and indivisible gospel. And at the end of that encyclical, Pope John Paul insisted that where God is denied and people live as though he did not exist, then the dignity of the human person and the inviolability of human life also end up being rejected or compromised, as though you can't have one without the other. Probably that's too simple, but we need to, I think, listen for the way dignity works in the law and listen for the gaps where it appears to be awaiting some sort of religious conception to fill those gaps. We do also have to note that some religious thinkers sometimes complain with equal vehemence about the danger of dignity becoming a purely secular concept. Jennifer, do you remember David Gushy? Was he at the Princeton occasion when we were together?
He was there.
Yeah, David Gushy, very well-known evangelical ethicist. And David, in an article on dignity, has suggested that the concept of dignity is a half-secularized remnant of an earlier Jewish and Christian concept best labeled as the sacred worth of the human person in the sight of God, or more simply, the sacredness of human life. Gushy thinks it is a relatively thin secularization of an originally thick theocentric claim about sacred human worth. I wonder, and I hope to show in these cases, that it's not as thin and as secularized as all that. Anyway, let's begin with a case in which dignity seems right at home. It's the first one on your song sheet. The issue is physician-assisted suicide, end-of-life issue. what are sometimes called death with dignity. In 2015, after much to-ing and fro-ing in earlier cases, the Supreme Court of Canada held that the country's criminal prohibition on assisted suicide violated the provisions of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedom, particularly the provisions that gave people control over their personal life. The court accepted that there was a difficult balance to strike. On the one hand stands the sanctity of life and the need to protect the vulnerable. On the other hand, the autonomy and dignity of a competent adult who seeks death as a response to a grievous and irremediable medical condition. That's on the other side. And the court suggested that an individual's response to such a grievous and irremediable medical condition is, in fact, a matter critical for their dignity and autonomy. Yoking those two terms together. It's a decision that for some people, said the court, is, quote, very important to their sense of dignity, that is consistent with their lifelong values and that reflects their life's experience. Now, there's nothing explicit about dignity or human dignity in the text of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, but the Canadian courts have long accepted that the protection of human dignity is key to its interpretation. And in this 2015 decision in Carter, the Supreme Court said that the dignity and autonomy pairing must prevail over the other concerns about objective sanctity of life and protecting the vulnerable. In keeping with the Canadian traditions of constitutional dialogue, the court instructed the Canadian legislature to come up with new legislation on the matter within 12 months, which they now have done. And so there we have it. Now, 2 points to notice about this case. First of all, it's possible to present human dignity on both sides of this argument. That is, not just talking about the autonomy and dignity, upholding the integrity of a person's attitudes towards their own life and their decision-making about their own life, but also talking about the dignity of old age, which should be respected and not simply sacrificed to, as it might be, the dignity of... Many of you people are much younger than I am, the dignity of 40-year-olds and 50-year-olds, as though human dignity accrues to us only when we are at the height of our powers. There is the dignity of old age, as the Evangelium Vitae said. Old age is characterized by dignity and surrounded with reverence, and whatever we say about assisted suicide must never be disparaging that, just because the dignity doesn't look like the dignity of a 50-year-old. And even the dignity of dying itself, as they approach death, people ought to be able to satisfy their moral and family duties, and above all, they ought to be able to prepare in a fully conscious way for their definitive meeting with God. So dignity is operating on both sides here. We need to understand that. It doesn't make a mockery of the concept. Most important ethical concepts can occupy both sides, and different facets of them can occupy both sides in a serious moral dispute. Think of liberty, and think of equality. It enriches both sides of the dispute. It helps us see the depth of what is at stake on both sides. It's not a contradiction that it can be used on both sides. It does mean that it's not going to decisively settle anything like that, but it is going to enrich us. The other point I wanted just to note about Carter against Canada is that in Carter, it looked as though dignity and autonomy stood together, reinforced each other in the decision for the petitioner. And that's led some people to say that dignity is redundant, that all the relevant work could actually be done by respect for human autonomy. I think our next case, if I'm not mistaken, the next case on your list is something called the dwarf tossing case from France, will show how dignity and autonomy begin to come apart in interesting and challenging ways. So let's move to this less elevating context, the entertainment presented in a rowdy nightclub in suburban Paris. On the 25th of October 1991, in the French municipality of Morsang-sur-Orge, in the southern suburbs of Paris, the municipal police were moved to close down an entertainment centering around dwarf tossing, which I'm sure you don't have in New Haven. I'm not even sure we have it in New York. They do have it in New Zealand, to my shame. Dwarf tossing involves, it's an activity usually in pubs and bars, burly young men watched by crowds of drinkers as they compete to see who can throw a dwarf, a little person, a person suffering from dwarfism, who can throw a dwarf the furthest in an enclosed space which has mattresses along the walls and on the floor and so on, but with markers to indicate distance, as though it were a shot put or a discus contest. The dwarf wears a helmet and other protective gear and a harness with little handles on the back so that he can be lifted up and hurled in this. And the police closed the show down on grounds of public order, claiming that public order in France comprised not only the prevention of fighting, but also the protection of human dignity. The organizers of the event appealed to the Versailles Administrative Tribunal, which overturned the police order, ordering the municipality to pay damages to the organizers of the dwarf tossing event. The municipality and the police appealed to France's highest administrative court, the Conseil d'État, and the Council of State upheld the original police order, holding that respect for the dignity of the human person is indeed one of the elements of public order, and that dwarf tossing by its very object, using as a missile a physically handicapped person who is presented as such. It's no accident that this is a handicapped person. Using as a missile a physically handicapped person who is presented as such undermines human dignity, and that therefore the municipality might exercise its police powers legitimately to ban this little game. Now, the decision indicates this point about human dignity that some people find disturbing, but that many others welcome. Human dignity is not the same, and protecting human dignity is not the same as protecting autonomy. As far as we can tell, everybody involved in this context, the burly young men who are doing the tossing, the drinkers who are watching, the owner of the establishment, the dwarf, even, who was being paid very handsomely for being degraded in this way, everybody was participating voluntarily. There was no evidence of duress. There didn't seem to be any violation of autonomy in the dwarf tossing show. Everyone was a willing player, and the dwarf himself, Monsieur Manuel Wackenheim, was paid very handsomely for his involvement. This was a consenting adult situation. So as I said, some philosophers have argued that respect for dignity doesn't mean much more than respect for autonomy, but the dwarf tossing case challenges that and invites us to consider that there are responsibilities that we have that go beyond our autonomy, responsibilities that we have for protecting the dignity of our own being and for not aiding and abetting others and degrading the dignity of their own being. Even those who oppose the ban feel some uneasiness about the activity. It's transgressive. The thrill of it seems to be connected with its character as transgressive, with its character as politically incorrect, not just in the abstract, but in the very delight that is taken in the fact that a disabled person has consented to be demeaned in this way. And so I think what's interesting in this dwarf tossing case is that it illustrates that human dignity as an idea is not necessarily emancipatory idea. It's an idea that saddles us with responsibilities as much as rights. And other cases where dignity has been mobilized in connection with degradation, I won't talk at any length about this, but in a German case dealing with peep show entertainment, the court has again said the issue of consent is irrelevant, because what's wrong with this, what's wrong with what's going on in anonymous pornographic peep shows is not that somebody's autonomy is being violated. What's wrong with it is that human sexuality is being demeaned and degraded. Human dignity is an objective value, said the German court, the respect of which the individual cannot validly waive. It's presented, human dignity is presented, if it is a right, as in effect an inalienable right. Inalienable not meaning very, very important, but inalienable in its strict sense of you are not in a position to give this away. You're a steward, not an owner. Which in other contexts, for example, in the theory of natural rights that lay at the founding of this republic, has most definitely been related to a religious vision in which we are, as I said, stewards rather than owners of our dignity. As I said, some people are worried about the moralism of this approach, and maybe it need not be parsed in religious terms. There is a dimension of Jennifer and I were talking about this just before the lecture, ethical aesthetics, partly, that people have a responsibility to present themselves in the beauty of humanity to the extent that they can. Certainly that's very important when we think of other contexts of degrading treatment, which do involve involuntariness. There's an issue of virtue theory. There are elements of paternalism. There's a complicated array of values at stake here. Now, just because we don't have unlimited time, I'm going to omit the next case, which is Beauharnais against Illinois, which is taken from my discussion in The Harm of Hate Speech. But I want to move on to case number four, which is Minister of Finance against Van Heerden, a constitutional case from South Africa in 2004. Here I'm using this case to show us how a government might take itself to be obligated to maintain an order in society constituted by its own actions, its own legislative and administrative actions, to constitute an order, which is a way of relating among the people of the society, an order among its citizens that respects the dignity of them all, and deals with the issues and dilemmas of public policy that arise without ever denigrating one group of citizens relative to another. Is it going to be possible for us to answer this challenge and maintain an order which certainly will, from time to time, disadvantage or advantage some people relative to others, but is it possible to maintain a complex, textured order in society through our law and administration and public policy, while at the same time insisting as a general background constraint that this be done in a way that is consistent with respecting the status, the dignity, I think even the majesty of each of the human beings affected. Now, the case of Van Heerden is a challenging one, using this idea. In South Africa, and actually until recently in Canada, the idea of dignity has been used by the courts as an index of what is at stake in anti-discrimination law. South Africa, modern South Africa, is a very good context for discussing this because it's a country that has felt the lash of unjust discrimination terribly. So Mr. Van Heerden, Frederick Jacobus Van Heerden, was a white legislator in the South African Parliament. His political career straddled the end of apartheid. So he was a white legislator in the apartheid parliament, and he continued to be elected to a legislative position in the new parliament. His complaint concerned the pension arrangements for the new parliament. The transition from apartheid had guaranteed the pension rights of existing political office bearers. That was one of the things that was insisted on at the time of the agreement. But arrangements had been made also for enhanced employer contributions for 5 years for new parliamentarians, particularly those who had been disqualified by their race from serving in the old parliament. So if you had a 50-year-old African parliamentarian post-1994, the thought would be he would be treated, if everything were left standing, just as though he were a new parliamentarian coming in, whereas he might well have had, in a fairer regime, a political career pre-1994 where he could have been accumulating benefits. So for this and other more complicated reasons, provision was made for the new parliamentarians to have enhanced employer contributions, maybe 20% of salary as opposed to 10% of salary for 5 years as a sort of catch-up. I mean, there's no guarantee that these men would have been elected 10 or 20 years earlier, but this was thought to be a good way of doing this. But Mr. Van Heerden claimed that this discriminated against established MPs by denying them the enhanced benefits. They only had the 10% employer contribution, not the 20% contribution. And the discrimination seemed to be a racial one, since it favoured Africans over white legislators who had been in the parliament all along. As such, Mr. Van Heerden said, it must be presumed to be unfair discrimination under Article 9 of the new South African constitution. Now, constitutional anti-discrimination law in post-apartheid South Africa is very complicated. Number one, what is prohibited in Article 9 is not discrimination per se, but unfair discrimination. Number two, there is explicit provision in Article 9 for ameliorative measures, what we would call affirmative action, if that is thought to be necessary to promote the achievement of equality. And number three, Article 9, like many of the rights in the Constitution, is also limited by a general limitation clause in Article 36, which says the rights in this Bill of Rights may be limited by law if the limitation is reasonable and justifiable in an open and democratic society based on human dignity, equality, and freedom. So the Minister of Finance argued that under one or other of these headings, the differentiation of pension contributions could be defended. Those who benefited from the new scheme were those who had been disadvantaged by apartheid, so maybe it could be justified as an ameliorative measure, or if it wasn't seen as an ameliorative measure, it wasn't in any case unfair disadvantage to them. And even if it was unfair, then maybe it could be saved by Article 36. Given the nature and history of apartheid, of course, the new South Africa was committed to taking equality very, very seriously indeed. Justice Mosaneke said that the long-term goal of our society is a non-racial, non-sexist society in which each person will be recognized and treated as a human being of equal worth and dignity. That's the aim I was talking about before. Let's see if we can create out of this havoc and mess of apartheid a society in which each person, now going forward, will be treated with equality and dignity. And that commitment to equal dignity would be embodied in the anti-discrimination provisions. Human dignity is harmed by unfair treatment when it's premised on the assumption that a disfavored group is not worthy of dignity. At times, as our history amply demonstrates, said the Justice, such discrimination proceeds on the assumption that the disfavored group is inferior to other groups, and this is an assault on the human dignity of the disfavored group and its members. Equality, as enshrined in our Constitution, does not tolerate distinctions that treat other people as second-class citizens, as though that's the way we had to organize things. So that was the challenge. And Mr. Van Heerden, in order to succeed, had to show that the measure, in effect, treated him as a second-class citizen, in effect, disparaged his standing and status in the new community, in effect, demeaned his dignity as an equal in the new community. You see, the South African court doesn't just use the dignity stuff as decoration. It actually makes it part of the test, part of the checklist that you have to deal with when you're making a claim. You have to show not only that there has been differentiation between two groups, but that the message sent by that differentiation is a demeaning or degrading of the group that is disfavored. And that, said the justices, was not true in the Van Heerden case. The pension arrangement did not and was not intended to and could not be viewed as intended to negatively impact on the complainant's sense of self-worth. We weren't saying that Mr. Van Heerden doesn't get the 20% because he's a lesser person, or even that he's being punished for the sins of apartheid. Justice L.B. Sachs put it this way: the old parliamentarians lost nothing. Neither their purse nor their dignity was assailed. They were not being punished for having been part of the old apartheid setup. They were simply being excluded from some special benefits that were given on objectively justifiable grounds to the new parliamentarians. It's a little bit like, and we have to be careful with this, it's a little bit like the arguments that were made in the segregation case Plessy against Ferguson around the turn of the century, where, to its disgrace, a majority of justices in the Supreme Court of the United States said that segregated railroad transportation did not constitute a badge of inferiority on the African Americans who were consigned to the cars at the back of the train. And you'll remember that Justice Harlan, in a very eloquent dissent, said it most definitely does constitute a badge of inferiority. Nobody who looks at it understands it in any other way. And that's a sort of test that the South African court was insisting on. Canada, until recently, used this test as well, a sort of dignity test. Not just dignity as decoration, but dignity as a test for distinguishing between mere differentiation and unfair discrimination, although they use different words from the South African case. until recently, persuaded by some very bad legal philosophers, the Canadian Supreme Court became convinced of the Steven Pinker view of dignity. That's a squishy, subjective notion, and this is making an unreasonable demand on the complainant to show that his dignity is affected. So they have insisted on just dealing directly with stigmatization rather than the idea of human dignity. That's relatively recently in the last 10 years in Canada. Anyway, I mentioned this because I just wanted to show that the courts have been using dignity as a touchstone of unjustified discrimination. Now, one of the things I'm trying to do with these cases is to try and see not only whether there's a coherent notion of dignity working in each one, but whether, in a sense, it's the same coherent notion of dignity working in each one. Because we have to look at the difference that dignity makes in the assisted suicide case and the dwarf tossing case and the discrimination case and see whether it is in any sense making the same difference or a difference tracing back to the same context. Stephen, you'll enjoy this. The philosopher Michael Dummett once said, how do we know whether a dog is in possession of the concept too? And we might want to ask, well, does he know the difference between getting one bone and getting two bones? Yeah, probably. And we might say, does he know the difference between being attacked by one other dog and being attacked by two other dogs? Yeah, probably. But does the dog know what's in common between the difference between getting one bone and two bones and the difference between getting attacked by one other dog and two other dogs? And we have to do that sort of analysis here. We have to try to see whether there is a deep notion of dignity with some deep understanding that might help explain its meanings in these in this variety of cases. Let me give you the case of the German air safety statute. Is that on the list as number 5? Yeah, okay, great. Now, I said at the beginning that it's worth looking at our experience of concrete cases rather than abstract speculation. Maybe that's belied a little bit by my fifth case, which turned on the willingness of the German Constitutional Court to contemplate a hypothetical and extremely unlikely scenario involving human dignity. Our courts would never have patience for hypothetical questions, but the Germans did. One striking feature of the 9/11 atrocity on the eastern seaboard of the United States was lack of clarity as to whether the US Air Force had the authority to shoot down airliners full of innocent passengers that had been commandeered by terrorists and were being used as missiles against buildings occupied by thousands of people. Those of you who have seen the Paul Greengrass movie United 93 will remember this, a major sub-theme of the movie, the paralysis that affected the military authorities. In the stable door shutting that followed 9/11, a number of countries sought to clarify this. They sought to make that authority explicit in their law so that this sort of uncertainty and paralysis would not happen again in future instances of such terrorism. One country which attempted to make this provision was Germany. In 2005, the Bundestag enacted a statute called the Aviation Security Act, which said in Article 14 that the direct use of armed force against the aircraft is permissible in cases where it has to be assumed that such aircraft is intended to be used as a weapon against human lives and where the direct force, use of armed force is the only means to avert this imminent danger. Reasonable, one might think, but not in the eyes of the Airline Pilots Association or the Flight Attendants Association or some regular business passengers associations who filed suit immediately to challenge this position. Their challenge was based, of course, on the right to life of those innocents who would already be on the plane when the terrorists took over and when the, is the German Air Force still the Luftwaffe? I don't know, but where the German Air Force took measures against such an aircraft. But it wasn't just the right to life. If it had been just the right to life, then maybe the German government would have succeeded in defending the statute, pleading that the provision was intended to vindicate the rights to life of the even greater number of innocents who were in the building that might be under attack, acknowledging that it would destroy the right to life of the passengers on the plane, but that the arithmetic of the greater number of lives saved might justify it. But the complaint and the decision of the German court depended on an insistence that the right to life be seen through the lens of that provision of the German basic law that I mentioned at the very beginning of the lecture. Human dignity shall be inviolable. To respect and protect it shall be the duty of all state authority. And the court said, you have to understand the right to life through the lens of human dignity. The state may not protect a majority of its citizens by intentionally killing a minority of its citizens, in this case, the crew and passengers of a plane. A weighing up of lives against lives, according to the standard of how many people are affected on the one side and how many people are affected on the other side, is impermissible. The state may not kill people because they are fewer in number than the ones whom the state hopes to save by their being killed. The arithmetic of consequentialism, the court was saying, was incompatible with seeing the right to life under the auspices of human dignity. And the court accepted that argument and struck down the relevant portion of the statute. Germans take Article 1.1 very, very seriously indeed. I've already mentioned the peep show cases. It's not just decoration. It's understood that Article 1.1 embodies a commitment that flavors and affects everything else in the basic law. It embodies, it's often said, a Kantian conception of human dignity. Kant, Prussian, German, and so on. And indeed, the court echoed Immanuel Kant when it said of the passengers in the airplane that the new legislation was contemplating using the innocent lives on board as a means to protect the innocent lives in the building. Now, strictly speaking, that's wrong. The Air Force would not be using the innocent lives as a means to anything. The innocent lives would be destroyed as a result of what the Air Force was doing, but the destruction was not an essential means. The crucial thing was the arithmetic, thinking that the numbers would make a difference, thinking that you could trade off life against life until you had no lives on one side and some lives on the other side. It was the arithmetic of consequentialism rather than the using of the passengers as a mere means that was objectionable. And the Kantian element here is just the definition of dignity in the groundwork of the metaphysics of morals, the definition of dignity as value beyond price. Remember, Kant said, whatever has a value can be replaced by something else which is of equivalent value. Whatever, on the other hand, is above all value and therefore admits of no equivalent has a dignity. And he said, human being, inasmuch as it's capable of morality, has a dignity in this sense. It's beyond price. Never made clear why this is the case, and generations of philosophers just take him at his word on this, and some think he must be positing infinite value for each individual, and that's perhaps one way of reading it. Infinite value would defy the sort of consequentialist calculations that the Airline Security Act was relying on. But I think what's involved is some conception of the majesty of the person of each individual, a high status or rank that would make it an insult to trade off this person, even against another person of equivalent high status and rank. People are not to be, they're not commodities to be traded in this way, even if you regard their rank as very high, make it an insult to trade off the commanding value of one life against another. The idea is that the world is inhabited by persons, billions of us. We have such status that may not be traded off, and we are required or commanded to resolve the ethical dilemmas that we face in a way that is properly respectful of this majestic dignity in each person. And that's a terrible challenge facing the German authorities, because they have to deal not just with their routine public policy and administration, and not just with the running of peep shows and dwarf tossing contests, but also the resolution of these hardest dilemmas that a government will ever face in a way that is respectful of the non-fungible, non-commodified value of each human person. Let me give you another German case. I think the next case on the list is a war criminal case. When we list our cases, normally we list the names of the parties. Germany doesn't do that, so we don't know the name of the person. Sometimes we don't do it either when we say Roe against Wade. Roe is a fictitious fictitious name in 1973 abortion case, but at any rate, whoever this German war criminal was, he was a man who had participated in selections and murders at Auschwitz and had admitted to committing relatively modest but horrendous total of 50 or 60 murders of innocent people, including women and children. And he was arrested in 1962 and charged with these murders and sent to prison with a life sentence for each one. And some 22 years later, he made application, as one can do in the German prison system, for release on parole, even though he was sentenced to a whole life sentence. And he made application, and the application was granted. And he was about to be released when a court in Frankfurt countermanded this order and held that he had not yet served sufficient number of years, despite the fact that he was now 88 and he had served 22, 23 years in prison. And the prison authorities and the war criminal himself made an application to the Constitutional Court. And the Constitutional Court said, yeah, it's part of our commitment to human dignity that we respect the capacity for redemption and the capacity for the moral regeneration of even the most hardened criminal. It's part of what we respect in every human being, that they have the capacity to turn themselves around. It's part of the function of imprisonment to participate in that rehabilitation. So in principle, there must be a prospect eventually of this man being released, notwithstanding the gravity of his crimes. The idea of life without parole as a sentence, except in cases of the most extreme dangerousness, is not to be admitted in German jurisprudence. And the European Court on Human Rights has said something similar about countries in the Council of Europe. Great Britain has had to face up to this, that it cannot use life without parole sentences. There must always be some prospect of release available in the distance. And not just compassionate end-of-life release, but genuine rehabilitation and re-emergence into the community. So the court was very insistent on that. He said nothing less is compatible with human dignity. Nothing less is compatible with human dignity. But it doesn't follow, said the court, that he has to be released whenever he says he wants to be released, or released whenever he and his friends think it's appropriate. The dignitarian commitment to redemption and rehabilitation doesn't preclude the fact that a long period of time may have to pass. And the court said, we don't believe enough time has passed in this case. Quite apart from anything else, they weren't convinced that the man had shown any remorse for the crimes that he had committed or properly come to terms with them. So the court said, the dignitarian premise is there, and it's always available to him, and if he comes back in 2 or 3 years, maybe he will be granted the benefit of it. What's striking to me in my account of this is it's using, if you like, the other side of the Kantian equation. Kant said it's partly by virtue of our moral powers that we have this infinite worth, or this non-substitutable worth, each of us, this majesty that each of us bears. And now the German court is not just admitting that in the airliner case, but now in a more pressing and concrete and non-hypothetical case, affirming the general principle that we must respect this moral capacity in each person. Not that the moral capacity is always honored in the person's conduct, as it wasn't in the case of the war criminal, but that everybody is assumed to have a moral capacity to turn their back on their misdoings and to go forward without that. We have a weak version of this in American jurisprudence for youngsters, juveniles, who may not be sentenced to life without parole. There must always be some prospect or hope of rehabilitation, unless there's some specific case on the basis of dangerousness. So that's a very hard case, and like Van Heerden, it shows that dignity is doing work, but not necessarily doing the work that the petitioner wants it to do in the particular case. As Jennifer indicated in the passage that she quoted, it sometimes looks as though dignity does its hardest work and its most forceful work and maybe its most religiously compelling work in the case when we are dealing with the worst of the worst among us as human beings. Dignity hooks up with the idea of human worth and separates it radically from merit and deserve and deserving. So I want to consider another difficult and troubling case. This is time from State of Israel. In December 2005, the Supreme Court of Israel, sitting as the High Court of Justice, considered the Israeli government's policy of targeted killing. You know, we engage in targeted killing of people involved in terrorism. In the Israeli context, it means preventative strikes aimed at killing members of terrorist organizations, even when they are not actively, or immediately engaged in terrorist activities. This is somebody who's a terrorist on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Saturdays, but not on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, when they work in their garage in the West Bank. In a long and very thoughtful opinion, the President Emeritus of the Israeli Supreme Court, Aaron Barak, rejected the absolutism of the contention that targeted killing was always wrong. He argued that one couldn't rule out the right of the Israeli military to use force against people who had engaged and intended to conduct terrorist activities, even when they were not actually engaged in doing so. There's no alternative, said Barak, to approaching these situations on a case-by-case basis. And that was the gist of his decision. I'm actually not concerned here this evening with the details of the outcome in this case. I'm interested in the premises he articulated for approaching the case. He said there are two premises, absolutely crucial. The first is that the terrorists in question posed a desperate threat to the Israeli people and Israeli society. Remember, this is 2005, before the recent lull in terrorist activities. Israel has paid a terrible cost in the innocent lives of its own people as a result of the thousands of terror attacks directed against it. So that was his first premise. The second premise I'm going to quote exactly as he said it, except I won't do it in Hebrew. He said, this is a quotation, "Needless to say, unlawful combatants, terrorists, are not beyond the law. They are not outlaws. God created them as well in his image. Their human dignity as well as to be honored. They as well enjoy and are entitled to protection by customary international law." Very, very striking language to use in a courtroom. God created these terrorists in his own image. And that is the basis on which we have to do the thinking that this decision requires. Needless to say, they are not outlaws. God created them as well in his image. Needless to say, but perhaps it was necessary to say it anyway and to say it in those terms, to pull us up short, to remind us that although we are dealing with a malefactor, an evil person, one who would kill and maim scores of innocent people if he got the opportunity, still we are talking about a bearer of human dignity. Not a credit to the human race necessarily, but a member of it anyway with the worth and the status and the majesty that that implies. Even if we're talking about somebody who is justly liable through his actions and intentions to deadly force, we are not just talking about some human beast, which, as John Locke put it, may be destroyed as a lion or tiger, one of those wild, savage beasts with whom men can have no society nor security. We're not just dealing with a good animal gone bad, or a demon, or an outsider to our species, or something that may be manipulated or battered or exploited or shot as a mere tool for our own purposes. The terrorist may be an evil and dangerous man, but he's also man created in the image of God, and the status associated with that characterization imposes limits on what may be done to him and constraints on how lightly we may treat the question of what may be done to him. So Justice Barak is effectively saying, even if I come up with the conclusion that targeted killing is in certain circumstances okay, this is not a case about what to do with about a dangerous car or a rabid dog or a dilapidated house. This is a case about what to do about human beings, and we need to rivet our attention on that question. And maybe his invocation of this religious idea is having that riveting effect. At any rate, the dignitarian idea is invoked and invoked by the other justices who joined him in the decision. The principle of human dignity limits what we can do to terrorist suspects. It limits the punishments we can impose. It limits the maltreatment we can give to them during interrogation, it limits the peremptoriness with which we can deal with them, and it limits how casually we can make decisions about targeted killing. Barak was mentioning this under the auspices of a claim that God created the terrorists as well in his image, just in order to pull us up short, not to settle the matter, but in order to say that the greatest consideration has to be taken with these judgments. So in a way, the case is about law. The case is about, we don't just set up a set of norms protecting ourselves from each other. We set up a set of processes giving each other status to make arguments and respecting the dignity of each of us as a potential thinker and rationalizer, person with their own perspective on the situation. And if it's okay with you, just one more case and then I'll stop. Some of you may be familiar with the use of dignity in the United States Eighth Amendment jurisprudence. I mentioned it at the beginning. There's nothing about dignity in the text of the Constitution, but the courts have consistently said, whether they're striking down death penalty or not, whether they're striking down juvenile whole life sentences or not, they have said the Eighth Amendment is about protection of human dignity. What you may not know is the case where this theme was introduced into our jurisprudence. It's a case from 1958, Trope against Dulles. Dulles was John Foster Dulles, Secretary of State, and Albert Trope was a man who in 1952, when he applied for a passport, was told that his American citizenship had been revoked on account of his desertion during wartime military service in 1944 in North Africa. He had escaped from a stockade where he was being held for a previous breach of discipline, heading back towards Casablanca. He was picked up very quickly, imprisoned, dishonorably discharged, went back to live in the United States, and then 7 or 8 years later applied for a passport and was told he was no longer an American citizen. He wasn't therefore entitled to a passport. The Supreme Court held that denationalization was not a constitutionally acceptable punishment. The analysis of Chief Justice Warren for the court began from the premise that the basic concept underlying the Eighth Amendment is nothing less than the dignity of man, and he followed the chief judge in the court below who had said, quote, in my faith, the American concept of man's dignity does not comport with making even those whom we would punish completely stateless. Fair game for the despoiler at home and the oppressor abroad, if indeed there is any place which will tolerate them at all. Chief Justice Warren agreed that denationalization was barred by the Eighth Amendment, understood in a dignitarian light. Human dignity required that people not be deprived of their nationality. There may be involved, he said, no physical maltreatment, no primitive torture, but there is instead the total destruction of the person's status in the society. The punishment strips the citizen of his status in the national and international political community. His right to remain in the country suddenly is called in question. It's not clear that there's any other country to which he can go. And this, he said, is why the civilized nations of the world are in virtual unanimity, that statelessness is not to be imposed as punishment for crime. His reasoning, Chief Justice Warren's reasoning, and that of the court below, are strongly reminiscent of the argument made by Hannah Arendt around the same time about rights and statelessness in the origins of totalitarianism. In a famous chapter entitled The Perplexity of the Rights of Man, Arendt was strongly critical of those who believed that human rights and human dignity by themselves inhere in the human person quite apart from his position under law, quite apart from his position in an organized polity. She worried about theories that seemed to presuppose a being who carried his dignity within himself without reference to some larger encompassing order. And it's always a temptation of ethical thought. We think, well, because the person has dignity in the eyes of God, we're entitled to worry less whether they have dignity in the eyes of man. But what if God commands us to work in our billions together through a network of systems where we organize properly, respect for one another's dignity, where we frame laws and set up processes so that people's dignity can be respected? And what if that's part of what it is to respect the majestic status of each human person. Law is not like an optional extra. Law is, I think, in some sense, a hallowed enterprise, required of us to ensure that when we gather in our millions or billions, rubbing shoulders with each other in society, organizing frameworks for each other in society, that we will do so under the auspices of articulate, known social arrangements that are understood by everybody involved to be preservative of and the embodiment of respect for our dignity, even in our millions. And I think for that reason, we need to take the exigencies of dignity very seriously. Dignity doesn't just affect whether people can be shot in certain circumstances or whether people can be imprisoned in certain circumstances. Dignity affects the question of whether people can be located and structured and live a life that is ordered in certain ways. And just as the anti-discrimination case from South Africa or the dwarf-tossing case from France worked with the idea that we are to organize public policy and public order in a way that takes seriously the dignity of each person. So, I'm arguing, the court in Trope against Dulles was saying that dignity is not properly respected unless there is a place for each person in such an order. There are to be, as Justice Barak said in the targeted killing case, no outlaws. Nobody who stands out with, outside, the whole structure of public order. So in a way, and this is the last thing I want to say, I'm kind of circled round to make the medium part of my message. I tried to present to you, for your fascination as well as instruction, a number of cases where the courts of the world have had to deal with the concept of human dignity. But I believe very firmly that that's the environment where dignity has to do its God-ordained work. It has to do this work within the institutional frameworks, imperfect as they are, struggling to make and remake themselves as they are, struggling to free themselves of the curse of injustice as they are. People are entitled to have that work done for them in the name of the law and within the fabric of the law, and to ensure that law sets itself up as a tissue of relations between people who respect one another as dignified in this way. So this is a docket, this has been a docket of dignity, a set of cases that illustrate the variety of circumstances in which dignity comes to the fore in human relations, but I hope also emphasizes this last point about the importance of positive law in embodying and giving life to this strong ethical and, I think, religious value. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you for an absolutely riveting talk. We are running a little bit over, but we will take time for one or two questions before moving on to hopefully more conversation after the session. So I'll let you, shall I let you go ahead and...
Is that okay? Yes.
Thank you for the talk. I'm having some trouble though seeing a single dignity and not multiple dignities.
Yes.
And I think it's hard to say which one is most challenging as I try to do different factors or in grouping, but the assisted suicide, having the same type, using dignity in that same way as for the others.
Yes. It's harder to see what's going on because particularly from this factor that it yokes autonomy and dignity and respect together in a way that the others perhaps don't. But with beings like us, who have faculties of thought, deliberation, and choice, autonomy is always going to feature largely in the big picture anyway. And in the order that we set up, in the order that we set up on a non-discriminatory basis, on a humane basis so far as punishment is concerned, and on an inclusive basis so far as this last case is concerned, is going to have to be an order that not only respects our persons, but respects our agency and respects our own decision-making capacities, our ability to mobilize our moral ideas in our own minds and take decisions according to that. So I understand exactly what you're saying about the assisted suicide case. If you present it, I think as many people do, simply as a matter of, if you like, aesthetics. I don't want to be on display in this humiliating state, right? And we respond to that, nobody's trying to humiliate you. This is just the way things are at the end of life. That will only take us so far. We have to confront the fact that in all these other cases where we have asserted the importance of the majesty of the individual person, given what we are and given the thoughts that people have begun to have about the organization of their lives, is it possible to separate that decisively from autonomy? For some purposes it is, as in the dwarf tossing case. So, you know, I can probably rig an answer to your question for every difficult case you bring up, but it's going to have to be an answer of that shape and character. It's going to have to be an answer that, even though I've sort of artificially contrasted it with other cases where autonomy is not involved, nevertheless, it's no surprise that autonomy was involved in Carter against Canada.
Thank you.
Yeah. At the very back.
Thank you. This is a brief two-part question. Looking at 7 and 8 together, I'm struck by the recent Yemen killing by the joint forces,
yep.
Ordered by President Trump. It seems to me that it didn't pass any of the requirements you mentioned for the Israeli targeted killing, or in particular for Case 8, and I wonder what that does yep. to the nation of human dignity and the dignity of the office of the president, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
But also, sort of back to the last question, it seems to me that overall you end up with a hierarchy of dignities here, dependent on each single law system, and in fact in the US many of the dignities afforded in Germany or elsewhere would not be present
yep.
here.
Yeah. On the second point, I think you're right. So we're not talking about a set of legal systems that have come into existence fully formed so far as the specifications and requirements and constraints of human dignity are concerned. This is something we are building together. Yeah? And you know, this familiar one step forward, two steps back, it's not an even or linear process. But if you were to say what is or ought to be the telos of changes and developments and progressive humanization of legal systems, this would have to be listed high among them. We can see that happening in the South African example, and we can certainly see it happening in the way that ideas about dignity circulate and proliferate in the world, so that we begin to take notice of what's happening in Germany and what's happening in South Africa and other cases. The killing of both of civilians and the loss of our own forces in the recent Yemen operation is an interesting one. All the evidence suggests that it was an ill-advised and not properly planned and safeguarded operation, but all such operations have these dangers. One thing that's very striking is that we have not had proper airing of the targeted killing in US courtrooms. Al Awlaki, do you know who that is? He was a US citizen who was killed by targeted killing. He was a recruiter for Al-Qaeda. Preacher. His father, when he heard that his son was on the death list that President Obama was maintaining, sought to challenge that in court and was told he didn't have standing because it wasn't him who was being targeted, it was his son, and the son would have to come into court and challenge it. And I was at a conference organized by NYU, and President Barack's successor as president of the Supreme Court of Israel, who's on our faculty, Dorit Beinish, gave the keynote address, and she said, "You denied a father standing to challenge the killing of his son? What were you thinking?" And there was stunned silence in the room when there were, I think, three Supreme Court justices present. And I remember hearing Justice Thomas call out, "I don't agree, but I'm listening, I'm listening." He said, but she said, "You denied a father standing?" It wasn't the only reason why he was denied a hearing. They also said it was a political question. So we have not had a proper airing of this in the courtroom context where dignity issues are supposed to be hammered out. President Obama, you remember, released a number of guidelines on this matter, but many people thought that they were not sufficient. And there's no reason to suppose that things are going to get any better under the current dispensation on these matters. So again, we're dealing with very uneven development. The Israeli courts, just like the German courts in the airliner case, are much more comfortable about relaxing the rules of standing, who has standing to bring actions in courts, and so they can hear more such cases. But it's also the case that we haven't had the opportunity as a political community to have the proper debate that we've had over and over again, for example, about abortion, or over and over again about assisted suicide. We haven't had the opportunity to have a proper debate about this particular form of killing that's going on, and we need to have that. Again, I say in the rather weak and flabby normative spirit, but I responded to your first point, this is work in progress. Yeah, this is work in progress. The legal systems that respect human dignity don't come into existence irrespective of what we do and choose.